getting more and more fun every time. So I'm Cynthia Spielman. I am president of this illustrious association. And do we have any new people that have arrived today?
Wow, two.
Could you introduce yourselves, please?
I'm Amory Hart. We moved here in December.
Wow, what part of the neighborhood do you live in?
West Russell Place at Blanco.
Wow, you are my neighbor. You are very close. I'm on Blanco and Woodlawn. So we'll talk.
Wait, I'm taking minutes. What is your name again?
Ann Weaver Hart.
She's the secretary. She's not just being nosy. Who else is here now? Yes, sir.
I'm actually not new to the neighborhood. We own houses. So we have a house there on Grant in Ashby. But I can always go to the Alta Vista Association, but I've never been to one of these.
Oh, okay.
There's a lot of concerns that I have. And I'll also be a candidate for city council for District 1.
Okay. I'm sure you'll find our association to be much more entertaining and informative.
I've been on to three of them, so.
Yes, sir.
Everybody, I'm Colin Morris. I've been in Beacon Hill for about 2 months now, off of Craig Blanco, so that's pretty cool.
You're also a neighbor.
Yeah. Good. All of you are neighbors, right?
Yes, right.
Yeah, pleasure to meet you. But
you're a next door neighbor to her.
Should I do an intro? Do we do intros?
No, we're just happy to see you.
Oh, thanks.
I do all the talking. I'm all on the show. Well, thank you for coming. So can we get to some business? Can we adopt the agenda, please? I have a few changes.
So moved.
Is it so moved?
But do you want to make
some changes?
I can't remember what they are, though. I think all I did was just switch one or two things around, and we'll sort of do that as it comes. It's not like I added something else. So are you moving to?
I will.
Does anybody have a second?
Yeah.
Thank you. Oh, we have to say aye?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay, so can we approve the general minutes for November 14th, please? The minutes from last month were Let's Party. You know, 350 people showed up for our neighborhood party. That's double of what we've ever had in the past. That's amazing. That's a really testament to people loving free food. are you all new to the meeting? Is this the first time you've ever come?
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like to, the others just introduce themselves. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. My name's Vicente. We're invited here by Mark. We're actually doing work on one of the houses here.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so can we approve the general minutes for November?
Move to approve the general minutes for
September.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Treasurer's Report, Daniel.
This is a sort of in case you pick up the sheet over there, I've got both December and November right here. I'm going to sort of combine them talking to you since we didn't have a meeting in December. Moderately expensive months for Pebble Fund and Thanksgiving and Christmas expenditures, but they also took in almost as much in donations and good protein. For general funds, fair bit of expense for newsletter. Usual maintenance on the RESA, which actually just went up a little bit this month, and then we bought and my toner and paper. But we also got a new advertiser and had another one re-up. So we're stay full on advertising for the newsletter. If I had someone call today, would like to be an advertiser, but we don't have a proof one right now. So stay pretty good there. We did also, just a side note, raise our advertising rates slightly for the first of the new year. Phillips Day, so it's good development, but income also. The one that took the biggest hits was part of the neighborhoods paying for that big part we just had. But they're still in pretty good shape, and I'm sure they've got some amazing ideas too. So, thanks for expenses, but still in pretty good shape overall. Yes?
Last item, when you mentioned it says Christmas, start with that one.
That's the park, that's the food for the park.
Christmas party.
Christmas, yes, so the network fund, that's the, that's what that says. So those are gifts and things that the network fund gave to families and fellow workers.
Christmas baskets. Meals. This is all.
In the benevolent fund, she delivered baskets of food and toys for families that the school had given her names for. I'm sure she'll talk about it, but that's probably what that is. Okay, I'd like to talk to you about Megan and Michael Pettis. They came last time, we block walked. The what? Mostly because I expect that crime is going to be an issue we're going to spend a lot of time on tonight, so I'd like to give you a little bit quickly. So on 715 Craig, Megan and Michael have asked to come to the Neighborhood Association meeting and present. Zud went to all of the two-block radius all the way around and door-knocked and invited people, personally told them there was going to be a presentation on that property and that we would like them to come to get educated so that they could vote on it. Normally, and we also left flyers, normally what people do is they go to Zud first. Zud helps them navigate what they need to know, and then Zud makes a recommendation. And they did it a little backwards, and partly that's my bad, but they came to the neighborhood first, so we didn't take a vote. We had a room that was completely filled last time in November because of all those neighbors. And they did a presentation, and when we talked to the neighbors afterwards, they seemed approving of it. I don't think there was anyone that said, I don't like this, and we're talking about next door neighbors, people who live behind. They went to Zud and met with Zud, and Zud has a recommendation. Before Zud talks to you about their recommendation, I will come into whatever we vote today, I'll commend them that this is the way it should be done. This is the way when a developer comes into a neighborhood that they take the time to talk to people, to put together a presentation, to come to meetings where they can talk specifics with people. That wasn't easy. There must have been moments where they thought, why are we doing this? And we're lucky that our councilman's office said you have to talk to the Neighborhood Association first. But it gave them an understanding of the neighborhood. It helped us understand what they were doing. And Zud's place is not to say, oh, we're not going to do this. It's to help them figure out a way to do what they want to do, but within the confines of our NCDs and our Midtown plan. So they did all of that. Mark Spielman's chair of Zud. He'd like to give a recommendation for the Zud committee.
In essence, I think the plan that they've put together is one that is more in keeping with the surrounding properties. Instead of being four long shotgun houses that they're allowed to build on the site, they're asking to get approximately three flatting so that they can put four houses on there that are more appropriate in terms of their design and looking for that. And when we're done, we asked them a lot of questions about how the parking was going to go, where things were going to be located, and they seemed like they've got a very good plan together. And so we voted this and we're supporting it.
The plan is on the back of your agenda. And so if you have any questions or concerns, you should ask now. Yes, sir.
I remember years ago there was on that property there was one big house storage in here and had the board of a garage. They had a garage department provider. Now this shows four separate houses. Now, is the current zoning allowed for four separate houses?
Mark?
Okay, hold on.
Yes.
We understand that from DSD that they can currently build four houses. They would be similar to what was built on Hollywood because they would be narrow and they would be long. So they would be shotgun houses. And after they make a presentation, if I can...
They're not going to present today because they presented last time. They can certainly answer any questions.
If you don't have anything.
Yeah.
Can I speak for just a minute?
Yeah.
On this? Sometimes we're faced with a least worst decision. And I think if I had total control of this and we had to do things my way, this would be a magnificent turn of the century, last century style house, similar to the one that was torn down. But nobody's building those, nobody's buying those, and it isn't going to be reality. So I think what we need to do today is make a decision similar to what we considered when we did Hollywood, is what are the other realities that are possible? And one is this shotgun style, and you know what I mean by shotgun? About 15, maybe 20 feet wide, and about 50 feet long. Kind of like a mobile home, truthfully. And our understanding after the ZUT committee drilling down with DSD, pardon me, getting over a cold, is that they can legally do this today and they don't have to come talk to us about it. All they have to do is pull the permit and they can build. But they took a look at this property and the surrounding properties and they realized that these are homes built almost 100 years ago with the character and the style that we're all familiar with in Beacon Hill. And they felt that the property really deserved something with a little bit more character than the shotgun houses that they had a legal right to build. But in order to do that, they need a little bit different configuration. And so they came to us with something similar to this. This has been tweaked a little bit, refined a little bit. This is, as I understand it, the most recent version. I think we're going to have a couple questions for you here. So the question tonight is, if we say no, we're going to have four shotgun houses probably, because they don't have to ask anybody. Or if we say yes, then we're likely to have, and ZUT has worked very closely with them on making sure that they're good for the word, going to have some homes that fit in with the character and the style of Beacon Hill. And that's really the choice that we have today. Do you have anything to add to that?
Pretty much it.
Yes, sir. Mr. Smith?
Yeah, just two quick questions. It looks like you guys are...
Could you stand up because the rest
sure.
of the...
Jonathan Smith, we are all the Common Board architects. Are you guys asking for a variance to approach the setback of the southeasternmost building that's over the setback and the porch on the building on the hill? The 20-foot setback on Grant Ave, the
yep.
one that you're looking at. So, yeah, what we're asking for is IDC. So we're trying to, it's exactly that. It's relaxing the setbacks for placing the homes where they're supposed to be. And what we want to do is do IDC with four residential units. So the setback right there, there's no, we have to be within 10 feet within the building. If there's any homes along Grant, we have about a 10-foot, you know, give or take, but there aren't any houses on this block face. So we said, let's just keep it right around 25-foot setback that we have, what we're supposed to adhere to on the neighborhood conservation district. So we're just going to have it right where the building starts at 20.
But some of them are over the 20, so you
The only one that's a little over is the porch, right?
Well, the porch is over, and then part of the wall, the southern wall, Grant Ave from the southeast over. Part of it, on my premise.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's coming, is that like a foot or so?
Sure.
So, just curious.
You can move it.
Yeah.
The second question was, all of the others, or the building topology in the neighborhood, all these Craftsman bungalows that have, from the porch, have a sidewalk out to the street, and you would be one of the few houses in the neighborhood that's breaking that, that they have all the ones, would you consider, instead of having the sidewalk turn to go to the driveway after all night on the street, like every other house in the neighborhood does?
Oh, I see. Instead of going straight, I don't think that would be too much of a problem. I mean, this is what we did.
Shouldn't it?
Yeah, it shouldn't be. And, no, that, I don't see that being a problem with just walkways.
Yeah, you said, add that.
Yeah, instead of going this way, just keep going straight.
It's literally, what, 20 feet of concrete, right?
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks. But this has been, this is our site plan where we want to essentially place up the homes and how it's going to be configured that we did submit it to the zoning, so, I mean, this is pretty accurate though.
Is this the site plan that will be submitted with your request?
Yes.
I believe with IDC, you're.
Right.
Yeah, site plan.
Yeah.
This is it.
We submitted it with our application.
Okay, so the application.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay.
What is your outside going to look like, your finish on your outside?
So.
Is it going to look like the rest of the neighborhood, or are you going to come in and put up that, what do you call it, the particle board and stuff like that?
Yeah, NDC, Neighborhood Conservation District, doesn't allow that kind. I think it.
No.
Yeah, you have to use wood or stone or stone.
The project that's going up on West Craig and Blanco?
Yeah.
Okay, that doesn't have, that to me doesn't look like the siding that belongs in that neighborhood.
If we can pull it up, you can see, I think there's a list of, we haven't even gotten to that point, so.
Yeah.
Design, we want to get through this first.
They'll have to adhere to this.
Yeah, whatever it says, we'll choose the materials.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Finish it on my end.
But a point.
Wait, Celia had her hand up, Celia?
Well, I was wondering about the rear setback, is that also going to be addressed with the IDC?
Yes, the rear setback can be five feet from the rear and 3 feet from the side is your setbacks.
Well, I think the current setback's 5 from the side.
With IDC, you're able to get up to 3 feet on the side.
Okay, so that's.
Yeah, it really, you know, relaxes those setbacks so you can.
Matt, to answer your, in the NCD, we encourage the use of natural wood siding, cement fiber, board siding, stucco, brick, and stuff.
So those will be our 5 options. Whatever that, what it is, we'll figure out the best.
I also want to say that I really appreciate y'all working with us. This is one of these cases, and I promised that I was going to write an article about zoning and multifamily zoning especially, but I haven't gotten the research quite down yet.
Well, let me tell why you.
Okay,
this is Jerry Lobby, he's part of the board. He's also the person that chaired the committee that did our NCD.
So we had 5 public meetings to come up with this NCD that the city helped us write 10 years ago.
I've seen some houses though in the neighborhood that really fit in the neighborhood. I've seen some that didn't quite well.
Correct.
Well, some were built before.
Yeah, but the one right behind Garcia's, the one with the brick porch, they built the new one.
We're all over.
That was before.
That's a story. Come to the Zed meetings.
Yep, that was before. But I do want to say that when you look at, so we're stuck. We have a historic home that was on there, but it has multifamily zoning. And that zoning is what I want to write an article about, because that was added as an overlay for basically Beacon Hill at one point in history, to kind of make the single family homes that were converted to apartments legal, because they weren't legal for a long time, and there were so many of them that the city had to do something. So we're it's multifamily, there's nothing we can do about it at this point. But what these great people here have done is one of the major things in the NCD is the porches. Porches are so important for single-family homes, and they have taken their apartments or single-family homes, smaller ones, and they've put porches on each of them to meet our NCD on both sides, the Grant side and the Magnolia side, which I think is a really a great thing that helps it fit in the neighborhood, even though there's four on a smaller lot.
Is there any more questions?
What did they rank? What's the price rate?
Hopefully we can start construction. Put them on for sale,
Build something and you don't know what you're going to sell it for?
We cannot tell, and we won't tell builders what to sell.
I'm just asking how much they work. I'm telling you how much they
sell. We'll see, and we'll definitely let y'all know.
They don't have to tell us.
Well, I was just asking.
Did somebody else have a question? Yes, sir.
Those trees that are on that lot now, there's just, there's a problem.
I think there's a couple, we need to look at where exactly the, they have them on the survey.
No, they don't have them on the survey, but we walked the property with our architect to make sure that we preserve as much as So, I think with the amount of setback that we have now, we're going to be able to save, or, we have some pretty close ones, but with IDC being able to get back a little bit, I think we're going to be.
That's what I think, We should be able, and that was one of our concerns, is hey, the trees are there. We have this configuration. Let's see where we can go in.
Because definitely with the shotgun approach, we weren't going to be able to salvage it because of the width.
And the good thing, I think, on the trees, and I have to double check, the driveways that come in where the trees are along the ramp, we're going to pave that alleyway, so those trees may be able to be out of there, so.
There's no tree down below here.
I think they're up
right
here.
Nancy, did you have a question?
There's water right here.
Compliment the developers on covering only 44.08% of the lot, because like in Terrell Hills, it's just ridiculous.
Green space is important too. Yeah, it kind of goes with the neighborhood. Setbacks are further back, but I think it's important, as well to have green space in front yard.
Any other questions?
I propose we vote.
Okay, the motion is Beacon Hill supports the planned site for 715 Grant, which will be this one, which we have labeled, the one you have in front of you, which was presented at the November 2016 and January 2017 meeting. They have met with the General Association twice.
I second.
May we have a vote by acclamation? Raise your hands, please. Aye.
Aye.
Against? Congratulations. Again, they have gone through, because of the time they've come twice to a General Association meeting, they've had the patience of Job, and rightly so. They're asking something of our neighborhood, but this is the way it's supposed to be. So thank you very much for your patience. Okay, one more thing before we get to the safe report. The board wants to make an amendment. We haven't done this for several years. The amendment process is we come up with the amendment by the board, we approve it by vote, and then we offer it at the neighborhood meeting, and we vote on it at the next neighborhood meeting, so people have time. This is the motion. We're not voting or doing anything. I'm just reading it to you. The motion is to amend the Bahana bylaws to allow those property owners that have properties on the west side of Fredericksburg Road that are within the Beacon Hill NCD 5 area but not within the boundaries of Bahana. One, vote for property on any actions that afford, that affect the NCD's non-residential standards. That's the, Skeeple on, either is one block on Fred Road, one side of a block that is part of our NCD. The city asked us to include it when we were going through the process, but it's not part of our neighborhood association. They have pointed out on numerous occasions how unfair it is that we make decisions about that block and they don't get a chance to vote on it. So this is an attempt to remedy it. We should have done this when we did the NCD, but we're doing it now. So we will vote on this next time. One of the big issues in our neighborhood is crime. I don't know if you've read the newsletter about the woman on Christmas Eve who someone broke her window in. She came in, cleaned out her refrigerator, took her TV, and most importantly, took all the presents under the tree. She had a four-year-old son who was, she was afraid that Santa wasn't going to come visit him. The neighborhood, when I wrote the article, it was to show what a community we are. People came on midnight on New Year's Eve, brought presents from their own kid's tree, a big yellow truck for this kid, wrapped things, brought food, boarded up her window, and then brought even clothes. Like someone said, well, on Facebook, what is the, you know, what are your ages or sizes of your teenage daughters? I've got a couple things that are new, we'll wrap them up. And there's a picture of him Christmas morning, this little boy just beaming with this big yellow truck. It was an amazing story about what a kind of community we are. What underlying theme is, it's also a story about the kind of crime we're having lately. So I'd like to invite our safe officer, Officer Brian Bigler, who I guess evidently everyone refers to as the specimen because he's so nice and cool, and when everybody else is sweating, he's nice and cool. So, the specimen, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm going to start sweating here.
Be afraid.
Yes.
Good evening, everybody, and Happy New Year.
So I'm going to go over the crime report today, or for the month of December.
So in the month of December, we had three burglary of habitations, one burglary of building, which was somebody's back shed, four burglary of vehicles, two robberies, and a discharge of a firearm in a municipality. Well, I want to clarify a couple things. So with the burglary of vehicles, one of the vehicles was momentarily left unattended. And I know I talk about this, and I always talk about don't leave stuff in your car, don't let it be visible. You're going to take everything out so you don't give them the opportunity to find something. But also, I mean, it's cold for Texas, it's cold. People start their cars in the morning, leave them running outside to warm them up. I wouldn't recommend doing that because you basically just left the keys in the car for somebody to take the vehicle. So it's one of those things, and it seems like in this situation, she just went inside real quick, came back out, and they had rifled through her car and taken some items. So it's one of those issues. Don't warm your car up. Don't leave it for just a second. I mean, we're in a great neighborhood, but there's no place safe in this world anymore, so you just have to be vigilant about these things. Two of the other burglary vehicles were Ford pickup trucks, and I think I've hit on that before, that thieves and burglars love Ford pickup trucks, especially the 250s and the 350s. But they'll, if it's not red hot nailed down, they'll steal whatever they can get their hands on. So that's just something to think about. The other burglary vehicle was actually in a mechanic shop. They broke into the yard and took some things out of the vehicle that were being repaired. In regards to the two robbery of individuals, one was an intoxicated male that was found late at night. Wasn't exactly cooperative, but he'd been beat over the head, and so that's one thing. The other one, it was reported in Central, it didn't occur in Central. So when y'all look at the raids online, if y'all have used that app, or when I'm telling you what was reported, it doesn't mean it actually happened here. So there was only one robbery, and it was an intoxicated male who got knocked unconscious. And then the discharge of a firearm, the only details that were given were individuals in his yard saw a vehicle drive by taking shots in the air. So it wasn't directed at any person, not that that makes it any better, but it was just shots fired into the air. I guess I'll tell them about that. So I know it was, thank y'all all for coming together on Christmas Eve. We don't see that very often, as sad as that sounds. people coming together like a community anymore. And I guess it's just a sign of the times, but it's great to hear that y'all actually did. I didn't get a copy of a report, or I didn't find a report for that burglary. So, this, I'm gonna touch on a couple of points with that. One, if any of y'all know her, have her contact me, or have her contact the police department so we can file that report. The other thing that I'm gonna touch on based off of that is the fact that if y'all don't call us when crime happens, then we don't know about it, and if we don't know about it, technically it didn't happen. So if y'all are concerned about crime in the area, which y'all are, because it's happening, the problem is if you don't call in the crime, we don't hear about it, it's not documented, or documented with all those beat counters, so you don't get more resources. So if you had 4 burglaries that were reported, but you actually have 15 that happened, and y'all can post on Facebook so y'all are blue in the face. Sorry to tell y'all that, but if y'all don't call the police, then I can't, the chief can't. No one can get y'all the additional resources that you need in order to make the community actually safer. So I can give you tips, I can give you pointers, I can tell you, lock your stuff up, lock your doors, dogs, alarm systems, call the police when you see anything suspicious. But if y'all don't do it, unfortunately, nothing's gonna happen. So, as usual, I'm the bearer of bad news. But are there any questions or?
So one of the concerns that we're having is, it happened to us and Mark was able to get our stuff back, but because of a woman who put all this stuff on Facebook, Facebook's an amazing thing despite everything people say bad about Facebook. For crime especially, you can't believe how many postings there are. There's guys walking through our neighborhood at night, sometimes during the day, just rifling through stuff on our porch or kicking down the doors, and we've got pictures of that. Well, somebody went on our porch, stole 2 big cement planters, antique planters, sold them, went to a store on Hildebrand, and Lisa Chavez, is Lisa here? Okay, so Lisa Chavez sees the guy, she knows he's been stealing stuff, tells the shop owner, he stole that. That's from our neighborhood, and you're buying stolen goods. And the guy got attitude and threw off the thing. She took pictures of the planters, put it on the Facebook page. I saw it. It was our planters. Mark went down there. He says it was a short conversation. Got our planters back, and we called the police. You know, we have those individuals in our neighborhood. They're drug addicted. There's all kinds of problems. But those stores that are knowingly buying stolen goods are a big part of this problem. If they have a customer, if the guys were going on our porches and in our homes and stealing our cars, they're selling it to somebody. And that somebody is who I think maybe we should start focusing on. We also, State Senator Menendez has asked us, Chief McManus has asked us to have a crime point person. I'm not asking for a volunteer tonight. I'm just saying you take that home, think about it, mull over it, if you'd like to be that person. And you would start by going to a luncheon with Officer McManus and other neighborhood leaders to get information about crime and homelessness in our neighborhoods. Is there any questions you have for the same
Officer Bigler, could you maybe talk about some of the options people have for reporting crime? And maybe if they're concerned about reprisal or something like that. Exactly.
Well, the simplest and easiest one is just dial 911. The thing about dialing 911 or even the non-emergency number, which is 207-7273 or SAPD. You never have to leave your name. You don't have to leave any contact information. It can be totally anonymous if you want it to be. Or you can say that you want us to knock on your door and make contact with you and whatnot. It can be anonymous. So that way you don't have to fear the cops showing up. You're calling on your neighbor, you're calling on the person down the street, the cops are knocking on your door like, oh yeah, is that him over there? That one I'm going, yes. You don't have to worry about that, just totally anonymous. Now, other options that we've made available is if you see crime in your area, but you just, it's not like actively happening, it's not going on right then and there. You can do the 411 tip app, which is on the SAPD webpage. It's 411 tip, you get on the SAPD web, right-hand side, quarter of the way down, you'll see a little icon for it. You can write the location, all the characteristics of what's going on, what you're seeing, the behavior you're seeing, the people you're seeing, and it's sent directly to our intelligence unit. The intelligence unit is required daily to take every single tip they get on that and distribute them to the follow-up units. So if you're seeing your neighbor down the street dealing drugs, and you don't want to get involved because drug dealers aren't the nicest people in the world, you can document all this stuff on this form. It's sent, goes to intelligence, it'll go to narcotics, and narcotics will follow up with it on that. Other options is always Crime Stoppers. If you have any information, you can always call Crime Stoppers as well. It can be totally anonymous, just like the 411 tip, just like calling the police. Thank you for bringing it up. A lot of people are scared to call the police now, mostly for that reason. So you may have a burglary, you may have drugs going down the street, you may just have a drunk in your backyard, you know, nearby who's giving you a hard time that you don't want to necessarily confront or have it be known that.
Last Friday when I passed by, that guy had a whole bunch of, a whole iron fence. He had taken off somebody's property.
And believe me, it has been a problem. I've known about it since before I came to this unit 2 years ago. So I've known about it the entire time I've been on Central.
Can we just say what house it is?
I will, if nobody else.
Yeah, please.
It's 1045 West Summit.
Thank you. I didn't say she's good. Okay. The problem
well,
is...
Well, you got to get familiar with the guy that rides the bike. That way when you see him in your neighborhood, you know what he looks like and you can keep a better eye on him. Yeah. That doesn't mean he's necessarily going to do something that moment, but I can bet you he might be, at least you're aware of it.
And that goes back to if you're seeing suspicious activity, then call. And the biggest problem we're having with that is, just like this, I reported four burglaries. That's all that was reported to the police department. Now, were there more than that? I can almost guarantee it. So what's happening is, especially porch burglaries, or porch thefts is what they're technically what they are, most people don't call those in. Oh, they stole my planters. Well, that, you know, that stinks, but what am I gonna do there with some planters? Or sometimes it's a bicycle. People don't have, well, with planters and other items like that, there's no way to identify them. There's no serial numbers or anything like that. Or people don't put homemade markings on there to identify them specifically as theirs. So it makes it very difficult to ID after it's taken. Bicycles, how many people actually have written down the serial number on their bicycle? 1, 2, okay. That's 3 more, okay. That's more than I expected, to be honest with you. Because bicycles get stolen right and left. Alta Vista just had several taken. And I don't know all the information on that one, but if you don't write down the serial number, they take that bike, they take it to a pawn shop, it's gone. Or he sells it in his front yard, it's gone. And police can't prove that merchandise is actually stolen. But if you wrote down a serial number or on the bottom of the planter, you just happen to even use a marker or something and write, Cynthia Spielman on the bottom of it. More than likely, these burglars aren't going to take the time to wipe it off. And, hey, he takes it to one of these shops. They flip it over. Hey, I got everything I need in order to pursue a criminal case on this person. Whereas before, and like everybody's seen it, you see the bikes in front of the yard. You've seen lawnmowers or God knows what else. If you don't have a serial number to prove it's yours, there's no way I can say, well, that's mine because it had the dent and the scratch on the side. And as much as I believe you, that's not going to hold up in a court. You understand what I'm
sure it is.
I mean,
why do you say that? What happened to being proactive? If they know who it is, who's stealing all these things?
But I can't.
She knows what her urns look like, and you arrest them and take them in, and they go to a court. What do you think is going to happen? You don't think the judge is going to say?
This is a totally different circumstance.
So I don't think so. I think that we can agree to disagree. If we've known about it for a year and nothing's happened, I don't understand.
Y'all may have known about it for a year, and I know it's a dirtbag house, but I don't have any proof that that's what I was doing. Now I've got one case, one possible case, and I've given everybody information I have about the history of the person, history of the house, history of that street, every goings-on that's happened there. I've given that over to property crimes, and the detectives in that unit are going to follow up on everything they can. Now, does that mean they're going to get a condition, does that mean they're going to get charged about? I don't know. I don't. But if people aren't calling in and people don't make those safety measures to safeguard your own property, or even just to, like I said, serial number. You write the serial number down to your lawnmower, and that individual takes it, and he has it, and I get it, and I can say that person there, that person stole that, then I can send that up. It's like in her case, vigilant person sees it, knows this guy's not nice, takes pictures of it, updates it, so we have pictures of the guy with the planters in front of the store. That's what I need. Now, that's what I need. You understand what I'm saying? It's hard. Don't get me wrong. I mean, like, my job, you want to save the law. Like, right and wrong is black and white. The law is so many shades of gray, it's not even fun. So that's what makes everything so difficult.
So Officer Bickler is here on his night off. So, I'm sorry.
Officer,
yes, sir.
Now I've heard a report about suspected fencing operation on Hildebrand. I take that from where we saw it there.
Yes, sir.
Now, the question is the police department going to open up an investigation case?
There is an active case working. That is why I can't mention names, addresses, anything of that sort, because there is an active case.
Well, there is an active case.
There is an active case.
Location.
I would, if I had a little bit more time, I could have possibly gotten the detective assigned to the case to come and talk to y'all about how the process goes after a patrol officer sends a report up. I'm working on that. And maybe at the next meeting I can have a detective come. Because once the patrolman writes a report and sends it up, it starts a whole new process. But if I could get an actual detective out here to go through it with y'all, it might help y'all to understand how delicate it is to actually get a criminal case and put it on somebody.
Okay, well, Madam President, you may want to bring such a person over to our next meeting.
Well, I'm thinking we'll do a whole meeting where maybe we talk about different, it'll be a crime meeting. You can invite the guy from the store owner, Marianne.
I was going to say, Officer Bickler, I know this is going way out and outside the box, but since we have a picture of this individual, would it be too much to ask that you carry that picture of that individual to all the other empty dealers in our neighborhood and let them know, have they ever seen this guy that are bought it? At least that puts them on notice that, hey, people are watching. And we're not ever accusing anybody of doing this stuff, but everybody needs to know.
It's not right.
I think that's one of our jobs, too. I think that's something we're, as a neighborhood, we're going to do is go to the local stores and say, please do not encourage this
behavior. Okay. I had to call the non-emergency on my neighbor because there was horrible domestic violence going on. I live in a really old duplex and the walls are paper thin, and so units responded probably within 5 minutes. There were four units that came. The only thing that I would suggest is to come in dark because they came in with their lights flashing and it caused them to shut down. And it made me look like an idiot because, you know,
there's nothing wrong.
You could almost hear them through the phone. That's how loud it was. And he was obviously choking her. And so, I don't know the result of it. I did talk to the police officers, but you know, I've already got a plan next time. You know, please come in dark, don't say anything, but you know, but it did make me look like a nosy neighbor that was just making things up. And so I did get a text the next day from my neighbor that apologized for me hearing them fight. So I knew, you know, whatever. Yeah, but it's just those things, if we do call in report, you know, are there ways to assure that, you know, they're not just gonna knock and say, oh, nobody's home, you heard things or whatever. But I really, I did call back and say thank you for responding very quickly, I appreciated that. So yeah. I did do that.
It's very complicated when we get a call for like domestic violence, especially if it's actively going on, we almost always go lights and sirens because we need to get there, we need to stop it. He was choking at this time. He could have been beat with a baseball bat next time.
Yeah, I mean, it was horrible.
It's complicated because there's times where we have like a burglary going on and we'll be going lights and sirens, but then we'll shut everything off so we can cruise up quietly and hopefully catch him in the act. But when there's an assault going on, typically we're going as fast as we're going very safely at a high rate of speed with lights and sirens so that we can address the problem immediately without, you know. So it's, to answer your question, it's complicated.
It's complicated,
I mean, I've been on the force, you know, over 10 years now, and every situation is unique, every situation is different. So you get a call, and trust me, most officers love nosy neighbors because we can get information from them. Because it's like, okay, so you called in and he was beating her up and she texted you the next day saying, hey, sorry about that. Well, the next time there's gonna be a history of, hey, there was a call there for a violence, a domestic violence. Nothing came of it, but any cop who's worth his salt knocked on the door and said, hey, is everybody okay? And they're like, yeah, we're fine. Do you mind if I come in and talk to everybody? No, I don't want you to come in. And if we don't have exigent circumstances to enter that house, and everybody's telling us they're fine, and we don't hear anything, we can't go in. Now, next time we get a call, and we walk up to the door, maybe she comes to the door, and you can see that look on her face, like, hey, yeah, everything's fine, but, you know, come on in anyway. And that's why I'm saying, nosy neighbors are the best neighbors. Call the police. Have to call us.
For domestic violence, someone dying go up if there's strangulation. So that's one of the signs that that perpetrator is more likely to end up hurting.
And that's the thing, a lot of domestic violence, and I know I'm going way over it, a lot of domestic violence, be it most of the majority of women, but men also, too, in some circumstances, they're afraid. They're definitely afraid of the person who's abusing them. So sometimes they need that extra little help to call out. I mean, we have officers specifically trained to help in those situations. But I can tell you from experience, I've been to houses over and over and over again where I know what's going on. I've even caught the guy in the act and booked him, and either they don't testify, the victim doesn't testify, or the case just gets dropped because no one wants to talk. So it's, nosy's better.
It's complicated.
Don't feel bad. Nosy's excellent.
How do you say the CRT, because there was a crisis response team, and they handle that at home?
They type up warrants, they sit down, they take interviews, photographs. Our CRT team is top notch.
Well, thank you, Officer Bigler, for coming out. I just gonna hug him because I'm a hugger and he's a great friend to our neighborhood. Speaking of crime, Mr. Yetter has helped us figure out what to do about the crime on Rosewood and Blanco around the Blanco Star. One of the things that we've met with the councilman's office and in partnership with the city, we'll have another meeting before this happens, but February 18th from 9 to 1 p.m., we need volunteers to help us clear out that alley. Nefarious activities are happening there, and the neighbors have been cited by code compliance. Most of those neighbors hardly have the money to fix their roofs, much less, and I'm sort of paraphrasing what Mr. Yetter said, a lot of them are elders, and we need to be able to help them clean out that alley and stop that crime on Rosewood and Blanco. That will go a long way. It's one of the steps, but I hope you can attend February 18th. The city's sending out a big bin. They're sending out people. People are volunteering from city departments to come work. Surely we can also meet the demand in our own neighborhood if city employees are willing to give a Saturday morning to come help clear that alley. It's on February 18th, but it'll be in the newsletter. It'll be at the next neighborhood meeting. I'm just kind of putting it out there. So we have committee business, and that's about it. Benevolence, Mrs. Eller, would you like to give a report?
First, I'm personally paid the privilege, and I want to say thank you also. Get busy, but I want to say thank you to the police officers because they have responded. When I call, they come to my house when I need them. So we need to continue to be involved and do our best. That's chapter one, chapter two. This Christmas was the most exciting Christmas. It is a joy to be able to supply toys, food, hams to 20 children. Seven families we were out and we delivered the baskets with toys. We gave out backpacks with school supplies to the children and the community. So this was truly a miracle on Lakewood Street. And I want to thank each one of you. They have so beautiful supported our benevolent fund. Thank you so much and Happy New Year.
Thank you, Ms. Eller. Ms. Eller is our neighborhood. Thank you, our neighborhood. Community garden, is Derek here?
No, but there is a garden work day on the 21st from 9 to 11. That's at Gramercy and Capitol. And for those of y'all that are new, we have a community garden on Gramercy and Capitol. There are, I believe, still plots available. It's $10 a year to have a plot. What you do is twice a year you're required, we'd like you to come and help and keep the garden clean and weed and that kind of stuff. It is right across the street from the playground, so it's great for the kids in that area too.
Thank you.